Hello, ladies and gentlemen. Thank you and welcome to your English program, Levi's Talk. Today we have again a privilege to be at your place because you and us have signed a contract and we love it. We are so happy for that and we are proud of you, ladies and gentlemen. Today we have a privilege, ladies and gentlemen, for our section on gospel to receive for you a man of God. And without delay, I'm going to ask this VTR so that you may listen to what he said. Hello, ladies and gentlemen. Today, in our section on gospel, we have a privilege to receive for you today a man of God, Reverend Jean-Leonard Matuluyeye of Mangembo Church, Mimosa, Democratic Republic of the Congo. With him, we're going to discuss a very good topic, which is extra time. Thank you, man of God. The first question that we'd like to know, why? Tell us why extra time.
It is about Israeli slavery in Egypt. When we read the Bible in Genesis 15, from 13 to 14, God told Abraham that your seed, your descendant, will go and live in a country that isn't theirs. There, they will serve and will afflict for 400 years. That was a prophecy God gave Abraham. God is not man. God is the truth. When God speaks, he holds an accurate speech. Amen. It did say 400 years. That God speaking, he is the master of time and circumstances. He has made everything beautiful in his time. It did say 400 years. But when we read the Bible in Exodus 12:40, the Bible says the sojourning of Israeli people in Egypt was 430 years.
430? 430
Not years. Not 400, but 430. 430 years. So when we compare the two realities, I can say that they are not going along. Mm-hmm. There's an extra time of 30 years. That's it.
Okay. But what do you mean exactly by that?
So, let's read the Bible. Okay. In the book of Ecclesiastes, chapter 1, the 9th verse, the Bible says, the thing that has been, it is that shall be, and that which is done is that which shall be done, and there is no new thing under the sun. You see, it also means that God told Jeremiah, before I formed you in the belly, I knew you. And before you came into being, I sanctified you and honored you a prophet of the nations. It means before we were born, God planned everything and finished. Indeed, devil cannot let you alone. Leave the will of God. Prophecy is not enough. When they give you a prophecy, you have to stand up, struggle, and make it come true. Mm-hmm. Yeah.
Okay, thank you. But what is exactly the message for God's people in this extra time concept?
Yeah, the message is in Matthew 11, 12, the Bible says, and from the days of John the Baptist, the kingdom of heaven suffered violence, and the violent take it by force. You see? So, we have to rise. A lot of people in life should have been married years ago, but they don't wake up. Israeli people, when they were suffering, they said, enough is enough. And they started crying to God. And when they cried to God, God heard. That is the beginning of prayer on the earth. Because Israeli people found it enough. And they started crying. Crying is praying. We have to rise and start praying for our life. So when God heard the voice of Israeli people, told Moses to go and set them free. The message is to make people of God wake up and struggle in order to enter their destiny. Because the enemy is not happy to see us going to hell in life. The enemy is not happy to see us living the will of God. That's the message. Okay. You know, don't be naive. We Christians are naive. Jesus said, John the Baptist is more than a prophet.
More than a prophet?
More than a prophet. He said that he has the spirit of Elijah. He said John the Baptist is more than Elijah because he was born with that spirit. But Elijah was not born with that spirit. The spirit came to him after being born and growing up. But John the Baptist was born with that spirit. And in the prison, he could have done something to be free from prison. But he didn't do that. Since he was capable to do it, that the same for Christians today, the Spirit of God is in us. We're capable to manifest what God put in us and set our life free from prison. A lot of people are in prison nowadays. They are prison of celibate, prison of poverty, prison of blah, 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 blah. So we have to rise. We have to rise and start praying and fighting for our destiny. You know, Moses went to Pharaoh. God told him, it's high time for you, Israeli, to be free. He went to Pharaoh, said, let my people go. Pharaoh refused. Could you imagine it? God says yes, and somebody says no.
No.
Could you imagine it?
But normally when God says no, nobody can say yes.
Nobody can say yes.
When God says yes, nobody can say
no. You hit a target. You hit a target. How come God plan your marriage for 2015, but till now you're still single?
Unbelievable. And you are praying every day, praying all the time.
And people say, Rabbi Olobinini, Ponali Balana. God spoke already, but we are sleeping. Yeah.
So we have to wake up.
We have to wake up.
So it means you are encouraging the initiative of the president, I mean, Mr. Felix Antoine Tshisekedi, who organized a mass in the NATO stadium to give the lands, the Democratic Republic of Congo, to God. He was asking forgiveness for all the ancestors, all that we have done in this country that didn't please God.
Exactly.
So you think that that is a good thing? That's what you are encouraging?
Indeed it is.
So it means we have been in darkness for a long time.
We've been in darkness.
But now we decide to give the Congo to God.
It is high time.
Okay.
It is high time.
Now, what's your last word?
My last word is this. In the book of Matthew chapter 6, Jesus taught disciples how to pray. Our Father in heaven, may your name be sanctified. May your kingdom come. May your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. May your will be done on earth as it is in heaven. Why did he say it? Because he found that life we Christians are living on earth is not what God planned for us.
Oh, that is discouraging. So we have to wake up.
We have to wake up.
Pray. You mean, Pastor, I'm a little bit confused. Do you mean we have to be praying all day long without going to work?
Not at all. There's a time for everything.
Yeah, you can be praying, but you don't have faith. But someone doesn't speak a lot. He doesn't pray a lot. He just say something to God and he believes.
Of course, indeed. When I say pray, there's many things to speak about, you know. It will take us more time. But when I say pray, including faith, you cannot pray without having faith. Without faith, you cannot please God.
Mm-hmm. Wow. You cannot please God without faith. Okay. And now, I would like you to conclude. And we have a privilege today to be in this platform with your wife. Yeah, can you say something to, I want you to look straight to your camera and say three words to summarize your topic and say something to your wife who is with us.
I can say your time is up. God blessed you already, but you are still sleeping. And it can be possible this year to reconquer your benediction. Rise in prayer. That is first. Second, as you said, that I'm with my wife here in the platform. She is looking at me. She's the one that I love. My honey. My darling, I love her so much. And my children also, they are at home. Baraka, Didim, Zoe, Annabelle, Elizabeth, I love you so much. And I bless God ever so much for the spiritual father that I have. A wonderful man of God. My father, Daddy Esperance Mbakati.
Amen.
My kind regards to you and your family. Thank you.
Yes, ladies and gentlemen, it was a privilege today to discuss with the man of God, Reverend Jean-Léonard Matuluyeye of Mangembo Church in Mimosa, Democratic Republic of the Congo, with whom we discuss extra time. But it is from now that we can say goodbye to you and see you next time. Ladies and gentlemen, in our section on education, we have a privilege to receive for you today Professor Dr. Albin Majambu Kalunda from the University of Kinshasa. He's an emeritus professor. With him, we have discussed something so important. I know today there are many universities here and there. People are opening universities, but they don't know exactly what are the priorities of the university. What are the priorities in education? What should be done exactly? Opening a university is a good thing, but what should normally be done in order to help the country develop? Ladies and gentlemen, I'm not going to be talkative. Let this professor tell us more about it.
I think that in the Democratic Republic of Congo, they put too much stress on the organization of colleges, universities, creation of colleges. There are so many in the provinces, there are so many. Not only colleges, teachers' training colleges, technical colleges and universities, In my view, a stress should be put on vocational schools. Schools to train people in the field of electricity, electronics, builders and things like that, because they can be self-employed. When students graduate, most of the time they don't get jobs. Every year, there are so many students coming out of the university, but they don't find jobs. But if you have people who can self-employ themselves, you can have plumbers, you can have electricians, you can have builders, and I think a stress should be put on that too. And that will be very helpful to the country. That is one of the priorities, I believe. And also, it seems to me that universities are not even financed by the government. Universities are living just with the fees that students are paying, and curiously, even part of those fees is sent to the government. That's incredible. Things should not be organized like that. If we don't have enough money for universities, we shouldn't create so many of them. So according to me, vocational schools should be a priority, because people can self-employ themselves. In that way, unemployment, we will be able to manage unemployment in our country. I don't think it's very successful. You know, when you talk to students, even those who graduate in universities, they cannot even speak good French. The kind of mistakes that students make, it's really surprising. First, teachers are not well paid, they are not motivated. And also, when they are not very well motivated, even the administrators of schools and universities, sometimes they are bribed. Bribed in the sense that people bring some money and then, you know, I heard something incredible a few weeks ago. We had a student, a lady who was in first licence AIA. She was not successful at the first session, so she introduced what they call recours. But as it was taking time, she went to another university. I'm not going to say which university. She went to another university, and she was enrolled there. Can you imagine where? She was enrolled in second licence communication.
Wow.
A person who has done first graduate, second graduate, third, first licence in AIA, in English, Business and Computer Science, that person, because she gave money, she found herself in second licence communication. Finally, she heard that at the university here, her recours has been accepted, and then she came back.
Oh.
And then she told me the story. I said, on what grounds could they enroll you? Second licence, and you are going to write a memoir in second licence when you were in first graduate, second and third and first licence in AIA? How can you imagine such things? It's incredible. That person was accepted just because she gave money. So money has become something, a parameter, very important parameter. So people can pass class because they give money. No, it's not a good system.
How?
It's not a good system. Which money? To be bribed by students?
Maybe. That's
no, not at all. Not at all. With such a system, we have very weak students who come out. They will not be competent. They will not have the skills which are necessary for them to find a good job and give the best of what they could. It's incredible. But curiously, there are some very good students who come out of our system and who work in companies here and there, but the majority are not very good. It's and you hear that. Now, if students are studying for grade, and when they will work, well, they will be working. When they will be on the job market, the grades will help them.
They will be recommended.
And that's another system. That's another weakness of this system. Mm-hmm. Instead of looking at the abilities, the skills of people, you see who is recommending who. Mm-hmm. And with a recommendation, a person can start working and so on. While there are bright people who cannot work because they don't have anyone to help them. They don't have anyone to recommend them, and that's very poor as a system.
Okay.
It's really poor. Mm-hmm. I've been in the system for a very long time myself, but I'm sorry to say that. I think that the top, that is chancellors, rectors, registrars, should be very severe. That is, all the files should be checked, and if there is something wrong, a person cannot be enrolled. I think we need to be very strict. Yeah. Because in the end, we come out with people who actually, can you imagine a person in second licence who cannot even converse competently? Now, you say you graduate in English, you cannot converse competently. What are you going to teach? Will your students be able to converse competently? Will they be able to interact with people who speak English as a first or second language? Now, what is the merit of saying, I have a degree from the English department, when you cannot even interact, you cannot converse competently?
But some of them are pushed by the...
That's right, yes. Actually, and it is a pity. Mm-hmm. I think people should consider what their talents are, mm-hmm. right, for a certain orientation at the university. We used to call him a brother because we used to pray together in the field, in the full gospel. Okay. He was a doctor. He was a medical doctor. And most of the time he used to tell us, please pray for me because, you know, at work there I have difficulties. He was working in an American hospital in Congo here. And the director of that hospital was my friend. So one day I called him, what's wrong with doctor, I'm not going to give his name, because most of the time he says, no, there are people who don't like me at the hospital. I have problems. The director said, most of the time when he operates on people, those people die. He's not a good doctor. And I realized that most Saturdays after our prayer sessions, he used to go to his farm with his children. He will take them and then they will go to the farm. Then I told him once, doctor, don't you think that you should have studied agricultural sciences? He said, exactly. When I came, my first choice was agronomy. But they sent me to medicine.
Oh.
Can you imagine at that stage? First he was complaining, no, they don't like me at the hospital. When I asked, they say most of the people that he operates on, they die. So he's not a good doctor. And when I asked him, he said it was not his choice. So orientation is very, very important. When we graduated from secondary schools, there was a system of orientation. They will look at your grades, they ask you the things that you like, and then they say, you'd better study medicine, you'd better study pharmacy. There was that kind of system. Now there isn't any. And the problem is that at our time, we used to be given a scholarship. Then the government could orient you. But now, when someone is paying for himself, how are you going to tell him what he's going to do? You'll say, no, I'm using my money. I would like to study engineering, mm-hmm. even when he doesn't have the skills to study engineering. And it's a pity. Can you see a doctor who tells me, no, I should have studied this, and he's a very poor doctor? Orientation is very important. What are the skills of the learners when they want to actually further their education at college or university level? What can they do? How can they be oriented? That's very, very important. Yeah, the government has a responsibility, especially when I say that they need to create vocational schools. It's the government. It's the responsibility of the government. We don't need to have so many students at the universities who finally are unemployed, who cannot do anything, instead of having structures where they can come out with skills that can help them employ themselves, self-employ themselves. It's the responsibility of the government. The choices of the government, that's very important. It's the responsibility of the government. The choices of the government, that's very important. Of course, the teachers may, that's very poor. They are not motivated. And when they are not motivated, you see the consequences. Yes, the facilities, we call that facilities. Facilities like this. This is a nice place. It's the initiative of the dean of this faculty. But this is very rare. You don't see this. That's right. That's right. But in other faculties, other universities, you don't see things like this. Yeah, it's only those old buildings. Sometimes the buildings which were left by the Belgians, which are there, and nothing new. Oh yes, he needs to be congratulated for this initiative, yes.
Ladies and gentlemen, I think it is important to pay professors well. When they are well motivated, they are going to be teaching well. So if they are not motivated, you know the result. So he said, according to this professor of the University of Kinshasa, he says that the priority should be put on, or the accent should be put on, vocational schools so that they may train people who are self-employed. They're able themselves to create jobs. They are not going to be seeking jobs, but they are going to create jobs. So we don't have to be job seekers all the time, but we have to be job creators. That is so important. I really loved from this professor, emeritus professor of the University of Kinshasa. I mean, Professor Dr. Albin Majambo Kalunda. Ladies and gentlemen, in our section on culture, we have a privilege to receive for you again today. So I'm not going to be talkative. Let us watch what they are doing, and they are going to discover.
Hello, Flora.
Hello.
How are you?
Oh, it's okay, nice.
Okay, we have a pleasure to receive you today in our section on culture, and you are very interested in culture, and here we are in French Institute, Aldi Lagombe, and we'd like to know more about you. Can you introduce yourself?
My name is Florent de Latulé. I'm a French film maker, and I have... a society with Renaud Barret, and together we have made many movies in Kinshasa, and we have produced some musicians as Jupiter Bokonji for the band Jupiter and Oques, Staff Benda Bilili with the movie Benda Bilili, and we were at the start of Coco Adventure. And now with the film of Renaud Barret, System Car.
Okay, you talked about Cococo, and Cococo played is a brand, a Congolese brand, and they played the background music of System Car of Renaud Barret. Can you tell us more about Cococo?
Cococo, it's a collective of Congolese musicians. We know them from 10 years, and they play music with instruments made with garbage or something like this, and very interesting sound. And we had a French producer called Debris to make a sound, an album. More electro with this instrument.
Okay, and how long have you been in this field?
In this period?
How long have you been doing what you are doing?
Oh. I'm in Congo from 2004, and we have made 6 or 7 movies. And we have worked with three Congolese musician bands.
Okay. What are the names of the movies that you have made in Congo?
The first movie it's a Jupiter's Dance. It's a journey in Kinshasa through the musician from the ghetto of Kinshasa. And the second movie called Victoire Terminus, it's about a female boxer. Okay. During the first democratic election in 2006. Okay. And this movie go to the Berlin Film Festival. And the third movie, it's Banda Bilili. It's about disabled people bounce from the street, like homeless in Kinshasa. And we have followed this band during 5 years. So this movie, it's about 5 years of their life. And but the first idea of this band is to make an album. But with the long story of to make an album in Kinshasa, it became a movie. And this movie was present at Cannes Film Festival. Okay. In 2010. And during this travel with this musician, Staff Benda Bilili, I met a Mutwa. A pygmy's a guy. Mm. And he told me a lot about his people. So we follow him from Kinshasa to the equatorial rainforest. And it became a movie, Pygmy Blues. Pygmy's Blues. Pygmy Blues. Yeah. Pygmy Blues, sorry. And I made another movie about pygmies, about women during their first child. They became like queen. And it was a theme around the Ekonda area in south of Bandaka. And the last movie, it's System Car, but it's not my movie. It's a movie from Renaud Barret.
Okay. Thank you. Now, among all those movies, what was the movie that attracted you very much? The big souvenir that you have, yes, the more attractive.
So many souvenirs, because each movie is like a big adventure. Mm-hmm. And so it's difficult to choose some interesting time, because so many good times with Congolese musician. But maybe the biggest adventure was with Staff Benda Bilili, because it was during 5 years in the street of Kinshasa. And this band, after the projection at the Cannes Festival, this band became very famous everywhere in the world. So the emotion to see this band become so famous, and when you think about when you start with them, you know, it's a long way.
What are the difficulties that you have encountered as a filmmaker in Congo?
At the beginning, in 2004, 2005, it was very difficult, because to have his handicap to work with a camera in the street in Kinshasa, it was very difficult, because Congolese people didn't be used with this. During the Mobutu time, they make no so many movies, so for the people it was like not normal to have a camera. Now it's easier to film in Kinshasa, because now everybody have a cellular phone or a mobile, so it's more usual to make pictures inside Kinshasa. So many policemen know me because they arrest us so many times, you know. But I have to deal with this, but now it's okay. I know how to manage.
Okay, good. And what are your plans for the future? Because you are still in Congo. I know that you love Congo. You've been in Congo and you love Congo. You love Kinua people.
Yes,
and I think that you have a long project in Congo. And what are your future project for Congo after this movie?
Yeah. So future project, I just can say a few words about this. It's about Royaume Congo with a car. Through an archaeologue. That's all.
That is your next, plan for Congo.
It's a big plan.
Yeah.
Because to do something about Royaume Congo, it's a big project, you know, mm-hmm. because Royaume Congo, it's many centuries of life of from this area.
Thank you. We are interested because we are going to investigate on Congo Kingdom, Royaume Congo. And we are Congolese and we are very happy. Ladies and gentlemen, this is the end of this edition. But before we say the last word, we'd like to ask Mr. Florent de Toulay to say the last words. Or what can you, what are the encouragements that you can give to Congolese filmmakers that are maybe tired, they feel like they can give up? What can you tell them?
During this European Film Festival of Congo, I met many young directors with many ideas, many creativity, and they are very interested about serials, and it's very nice to meet this creativity because Kinshasa or Congo, they are so creative. So I imagine in the future they can make more than Nigeria about cinema.
Okay.
You know, so many stories to tell here.
Ladies and gentlemen, now it is time to learn. You know, the limits of your language are the limits of your world. So, je voudrais dire, là où vous êtes linguistiquement limité, c'est là où votre monde se limite. Vous ne pouvez pas parler avec un Américain si vous ne comprenez pas l'anglais. Sinon, il va dire, how are you? Vous dites, I come from home. Donc, il n'y a pas communication. Maintenant, il est temps d'apprendre. Prenez votre stylo, votre cahier et apprenez avec moi. Aujourd'hui, commençons par les noms. Nous avons en anglais first name, given name et Christian name pour parler des prénoms. Répétez avec moi. First name, given name, Christian name. Et nous avons middle name, post name pour parler des post-noms. Répétez avec moi. Middle name, post name. Et nous avons last name, family name et surname pour parler des noms de famille. Répétez encore avec moi. Last name, family name, surname. En anglais, c'est pas comme en français. Nous avons nom, post-nom, prénom en français. Par exemple, Messia Mungo Ruth. Mais en anglais, il faut juste inverser. Les prénoms vont à la place des noms de famille et les noms de famille viennent à la place des prénoms. Du coup, nous aurons Ruth, Mungo, Messia. Et premier en anglais, on dit first. Et dernier en anglais, on dit last. Et le millier en anglais, on dit middle. Voilà pourquoi le first name, c'est le prénom. Le middle name, c'est le nom du millier, donc le post-nom. Et le last name, c'est le nom des familles. Mais pour le post-nom, nous avons deux possibilités. Soit on peut seulement prendre l'initiale, par exemple, Ruth M. Messia. M qui représente Mungu, qui est le post-nom. Soit on peut carrément l'enlever. Là, nous aurons Ruth Messia. Et ça, c'est le plus utilisé. Et nous avons aussi d'autres cas, par exemple, Donald Trump. Nous avons Barack Obama. Il est difficile de connaître les post-noms des Américains et des Anglo-Saxons parce que seulement pour la simple raison que pour eux, les post-noms n'est pas très important. Voilà pourquoi, si je vous demande aujourd'hui le prénom de Donald Trump, il serait difficile pour vous de trouver la réponse. Donc nous avons Donald Trump, Barack Obama, Levis Ney, and so on. Il y a quelque chose de très important, vraiment très important, que nous voudrions partager avec vous aujourd'hui. Aujourd'hui, nous voulons insister sur le mot surname. Surname, en français, ce n'est pas surnom. Le mot surnom en français, en anglais, on le dit nickname. Donc, surname, c'est le nom de famille et nickname, c'est le surnom. Il ne faut pas être trompé par l'apparence de ces mots « surname ». Soulignez ces mots. Nous avons encore « maiden name ».« Maiden name », c'est le nom de la jeune fille. C'est-à-dire, une femme avant d'être mariée, elle avait son nom de famille, mais lorsqu'elle est mariée à X, elle a porté désormais le nom de son mari, mais elle peut aussi recourir à son nom originel. C'est ce qu'on appelle « maiden name ». Et nous avons full name. Full name, c'est pour parler des noms complets. Tous les noms, si vous en avez 18, tous les 18 noms font ce qu'on appelle full name. Exercise. Exercise. Il y a des questions auxquelles vous devez répondre. Nous avons, what's your first name? My first name is... And what's your last name? My last name is... Pratiquez avec votre partenaire. Allons-y. What's your first name? My first name is... And what's your last name? My last name is... Maintenant, parlons de ce que nous appelons possessive adjectives. Répétez après moi. Possessive adjectives. Possessive adjectives. Écoutez et répétez. My. Your. His. Her. Its. Our. Your, there. Ici, nous sommes en train de parler de mon, ton, son, notre, votre, leur. Ma, ta, sa, notre, votre, leur. Mes, tes, ses, nos, vos, leur. Ici, le nombre ou le genre du mot qui vient après n'influence pas ces mots ici. Par exemple, je peux parler de my mother. Ma mère, my father, mon père, my pen, mon stylo, my pens, mes stylos. Donc, ces mots ici ne changent pas, sauf les mots qui viennent après peuvent subir des modifications. Nous avons maintenant une série de questions et réponses. What's your name? My name is Levis Ney. What's my full name? Your full name is Gatsby Kabakele. What's his address? His address is 52 Nyuki Street. What's her phone number? Her phone number is 22545. Une note très importante, mesdames et messieurs. Nous utilisons his pour tout ce qui appartient à un homme, quel que soit son genre. Par exemple, si on veut parler de sa femme, la femme d'un homme, on dit his wife. Son enfant, his child, c'est bien, his staff. Son nom, his name. Et lorsque nous parlons d'une femme, tout ce qui appartient à une femme dont la référence est une femme, on utilise her. Her name, her husband, her children, her cousin. Donc le fait de dire her husband ne veut pas dire sa mari. Non, ça veut justement dire son mari. Mais comme la référence est une femme, on utilise her. Nous avons les mots qui nous aident à poser des questions. Par exemple, what's, qui veut dire what is, pour les choses au singulier. Et nous avons what are, ou what are, pour les choses qui sont au pluriel. Passons à cet exercice. Exercise. Exercise. Répétez après moi. Exercise. Replace the underlined words by his, her, or their. Dans ces phrases qui suivent, il y a des mots qui sont soulignés et on vous demande de les remplacer par his, soit par her, soit par their. Le premier exemple est là. Patrick's last name is Iso. Complétez la phrase. Merci. Rachel's favorite food is rice. Complétez la phrase. Paul and Suzanne's children are happy. Complétez la phrase. John's address is 1 Kinshasa Street. Complétez la phrase. Merci, vous êtes vraiment intelligent. Merci beaucoup. Thank you, ladies and gentlemen. Better the end of something rather than its beginning. We are at the end. I still think that you still need me, but I'm not sure because time is money. I have the obligation to leave you today. But see you next time for the next number. Goodbye from Kinshasa.